How are you all doing today? Everybody having an exciting day of Python? It's also a somewhat tiring day. You get a lot of information coming at you all at once and things like this, so I know how that goes. So my name is Kojo, and I'm going to be talking to you today about Python and spreadsheets. And I'm calling this a State of the Union as of October 2014. It's a little bit about me. I describe myself as a rogue Pythonista. I'm one of the few people here at a conference like this who is not a professional programmer. So I think when Jesse Noller was giving his presentation, he asked people to raise their hands if you get paid to do Python or if you are a student. He said, some people didn't raise their hands. I was one of those people. I am paid money to be an accountant, but I've also had an interest in programming for a long time. Accounting is a data-driven field. Programming is the processing of data, so it seems like a good fit. So that's a little bit of background about me, and some of that detail will become relevant as we go through the talk. So a little bit of setup, a little bit of background here. There's not going to be a lot of code in this presentation, and that is largely because the interesting code is going to be provided based on whatever your particular use case is. So the code examples that I would provide would be very sort of hello world-ish type things. So I'm not going to really show really anything in the way of code here. I've got some code that I can show you if you just want to see some code, but my code's not all that spectacular. I think what's a little more interesting are the different applications here, the different use cases. But I've given this talk, I gave a version of this talk in last year here at PyTexas, but also for our local Python Houston user group. And it has occurred to me that the context in which I give this talk, or the background, so we'll go into that a little bit here. So my role as a Python contributor, I have talked a few moments ago about how I'm not a professional developer. I don't do development full-time every day. And so one of the things that I wanted to try to do to make a contribution to the Python community is to try to help grow the community and to help make it larger. And my feeling was that the best growth vector for the Python community is not by converting C and Java and programmers into Python programmers, but to convert non-programmers into Python programmers. One, simply because if you're already programming in some other environment, you've got some sort of technical or emotional attachment to that. But then two, there are simply more non-programmers than there are programmers. And so converting those people into Pythonistas is probably going to be a better growth vector, in my opinion. So that's the approach I'm taking. So why is that relevant here? What I'm going to be talking about today, and what I've talked about in this talk before, are solutions that are designed largely for people who might not be developers. And you're going to have two main audiences here. When I've given this talk before, or talked about these sorts of things, when you speak to a room full of developers about them, about dealing with data that comes out of a spreadsheet or something, you'll hear a number of different responses like, well, just put that in a database, or do this, or do that. And those are all excellent solutions. Those are all perfectly valid solutions, provided you have the skill set or access to those tools to actually make those solutions work. In a situation like this, if you're dealing with spreadsheets a lot, the most advanced technology that people may have available to them or that they may feel comfortable with would be a spreadsheet itself. And so the reason you're getting a spreadsheet is because all we've got is spreadsheets. You're getting a spreadsheet or you're getting a spreadsheet because there was an application, some sort of a database backed application that exported its data as a spreadsheet. So so there are a lot of solutions that will, and I point that out here because here at PyTexas, again, most people are going to be developers. So all sorts of solutions that are obvious to a developer would come to mind. But what I'm looking at is a situation where you're not dealing with developers in most cases. That's the data point there. So the two primary audiences for this, a talk like this, and coming at it from two different angles. One is spreadsheet users who want to step their game up. So if you're somebody who works with spreadsheets all day, all the time, and you're realizing, you know what, there's got to be some sort of a better way to do this stuff. You know, I've got to be able to do this in a way that's not manually, it's not manual. I don't want to have to point and click, point and click, point and click. One example I may show you is a situation where I took a process that used to require 6+ hours of manual point click in the UI. Even a basic programmer realizes this is dumb, and you can change it to a process that takes about 120 seconds. Maybe longer on my MacBook Air because it's not the most powerful of machines, but you know, a few minutes as opposed to a few hours. So that's one audience for this. People who are not programmers, but have to deal with lots of spreadsheets and think there must be some sort of better way. And that again ties in with my goal of trying to help grow the community by turning non-programmers into programmers. But the other audience is going to be probably most of the people here in the room, and that's going to be Python developers who suddenly find themselves confronted with spreadsheets. So maybe in your day-to-day job, you were writing code and you didn't have to worry about spreadsheets, but something happens, something changes, you get a new boss, your boss gets a new boss, your company gets acquired by another company, your company acquires another company, something changes. And now, suddenly, spreadsheets are in your email box like every week or every month or on some sort of consistent basis. And you've got these spreadsheets and you're like, this is dumb. Why am I learning visual? I'm not gonna learn Visual Basic. You know, that's nonsense. So what are my options to deal with this data in a way that's better? And again, as a developer, you might have other options like putting it into a database, or you can save the file as a CSV, and there are many well-known sort of well-formed solutions for dealing with CSV files. I'm not going to go into those really here because I wanted to take a different approach, because again, if you are of the mindset of, oh, well, I'll just take this file, convert it to a CSV, and once it's in a CSV, I can process it in the way I see fit, well, you're not the typical spreadsheet user. So I'm looking here at things that are going to be accessible to the typical spreadsheet user, but also sort of getting rid of that intermediate step of converting files between different formats. And so that's sort of the background here. Because again, as you start to look through this, a lot of other solutions may come into the mind of a typical Python developer. But this is sort of some background as to why I'm presenting this set of solutions or presenting this particular approach. So with that groundwork laid, we look at the three different approaches I'll be taking a look at. The first of the three is working with a spreadsheet file. So here, you're not working with an actual application itself. You've just got a spreadsheet file, an XLSX file, or an XLS file, the older Excel format. Maybe an ODT file, although I have found that ODS? The OpenOffice/LibreOffice format, although I've run into a little bit of difficulty in dealing with those files, and we'll talk about that later. But here, in approach one, you're dealing with just the spreadsheet file itself, not the actual spreadsheet application, but just the spreadsheet file itself, just the spreadsheet data file. The second option is using Python code inside of a spreadsheet application. So here in option two, you've got your spreadsheet application and maybe you're using it, you're fine with it, you're comfortable with it, but you'd like to be able to run some Python code within that spreadsheet application. And so that's the second option that we'll look at, and there are some options there. Option three is the option that I'm still researching and that still isn't as well developed as I'd like, where you're scripting the spreadsheet application itself. So you are either maybe not directly using the spreadsheet application through its GUI, but you're writing code that will then manipulate the spreadsheet application and get it to do certain things for you. And so sort of using it as almost as if it were like a web service or something, or in the way you would script another application. So those are the three approaches we'll be looking at. Then there are some other options that I'm sort of looking at. I'd started to look into in the course of doing this. You know, there's a lot of research and looking at different options, that sort of thing. And the reason I call this talk the State of the Union as of October 2014 is when I started looking into this in maybe June or July of 2013, there were certain options that were available. And now, a year or so later, the landscape has changed quite a bit. And so there are new options that are available, and I'm sure that will continue to be the case going forward. So there's always something new that pops up. It's, oh, well, here's another option. So but essentially what I'll be talking about today are these three primary options. So option one, working with spreadsheet files. And the use case here, is that still legible for the people in the back? Okay. So the use case option here, working with spreadsheet files, is you've been given a spreadsheet of data but it's not convenient to process it manually through your spreadsheet application. So you've got a spreadsheet and you need to work with it. This option, I think, is probably one of the most flexible, because especially for a Python programmer, because in this case, all you would need is the spreadsheet file itself, and then a library that lets you work with that spreadsheet, and then you can do the processing on your own. But I think this also might be useful to someone who is new to Python, because all they would need to do is get Python installed, you know, and running on their machine, and then install one additional library, and boom. And depending on how they get Python installed, some of the distributions might already have that library installed. But this, I think, is a fairly flexible method. Again, a perfect entry point for new Pythonistas. If you are working with spreadsheets a lot already, it is close to programming. I have friends who do functional programming, Haskell, that sort of thing, and I told them, well, you know, I'm doing stuff in Python. First, as a show of hands, how many of you use spreadsheets on a fairly regular basis? Okay, and so you know that you can get, say, Excel to do certain things for you, but it requires a certain amount of wrangling and maybe a lot of, you know, using the output of one function as the input of another function, as the input of another function. You get these crazy nested functions. I tried to convince one of my friends who does Haskell programming, well, this is functional programming, right? Because I'm using functions. And they were like, no, not really. So I tried, though. But if you're someone who spends a lot of time in spreadsheets, between writing the different mathematical formulas and doing the different computations and using the different Excel functions, you know, there's a bit of a programming mindset that's already in place, and so it's not a huge leap going forward. So what are some of your options here? The library that I've used the most is OpenPyXL, and this is an open source project. You can get it from PyPy. It works with Python 2.6 or greater. And it works with XLSX files, so this is the newer Excel format. And just as a reminder, there's the XLS format, which is the older from, I think, Excel 2003 and earlier, and then the newer XLSX format. OpenPyXL does not work with that older format, and so if you need that older format, if you need something that works with the older format, we'll see a library that will work with you there. I've demoed a larger example program. The example that I'll show you is a result that I generated from using OpenPyXL for a task that I needed to have done at work. But the other option here, one of the other primary options here is PythonXL, which is actually a series of packages. It's a series of libraries. It's not just one. You get XLRD, which is for reading Excel files, and the names are fairly self-explanatory. XLWT for writing, and then a set of utilities that are useful for working with Excel files. A year ago, when I started looking at this, the Python XL packages would only work with the XLS format. They would not work with the XLSX format, the newer format. But now, that's been changed so that the Python XL packages will work with both the newer and the older formats. So they're both under active development. As far as someone who is new to Python or relatively new to trying to do this sort of thing, I'd recommend OpenPyXL just because the documentation is a little better, a little clearer, I've found, and also a little more up to date. So I think the documentation, at last check, the documentation for the Python XL packages was referencing like the 0.72 version of the packages, whereas those packages themselves are now like at 0.9. And I believe those 0.7 packages that are referenced in the documentation are the ones that would not handle the XLSX format. So that's one thing to point out. But again, depending on what you're doing, if you need to work with XLS.xls files, you might need these packages. Again, if you've got spreadsheets that are sort of coming to you now suddenly, there's a good chance that those may be coming from some sort of database-backed application that has as one of its functions the ability to generate some sort of a report and spit it out in an Excel format. Well, if that was done, depending on where you're working and what your enterprise IT situation is, that might be a relatively old application. And so it might only spit out things in the XLS format. And so one option would be to just manually convert it from XLS to XLSX. But if you wanted to sort of avoid that step, or if you've got just a lot of XLS format files coming at you, you might be better off with a library that has the native ability to handle them. So it'll depend on your use case. So if you're working with the ODS files, the Open Document Foundation's files, I've run into the OpenPyXL, I know for a fact, doesn't work very well with those. And so if you start at the opendocumentformat.org site, they've got a list of resources there for you, and they've got a list of different languages that you can work with. And of course, Python's at the top, which is nice, as I think it should be, but I'm biased, of course. So example results. So I'll show you a quick example, partially just because, just sort of an example of, okay, well why would I need Python to deal with a spreadsheet? So let's see, now that might not be as big as we want. Resize this. So this is that, you know, is that visible? Yes? No? Okay. Let me see what I can do here. Put that up a little bit. That's probably better, yeah? So what I've got here is some compressed timesheet data. In its original format, this was if you've worked in a professional services firm, say an accounting firm or a law firm or an engineering firm, where people need to fill out timesheets because they're working on billable projects, then you might have seen something like this before. So let's say in a typical workday, you may work on two or three different projects that your company is billing out. Well, you need to record, okay, well, I spent X amount of time working on billable project one, X amount of time working on billable project two. But then out of my 8-hour day today, I spent 2 hours doing administrative stuff. So it was nothing, it wasn't billable. And so that's what we've got here. So your company name, different company organizations, the sub-department you're in, this employee number and employee name just identifies the employee. I've anonymized these to protect the innocent, who your manager is. Then this bench and billable, these are the number of hours that you spent, quote unquote, on the bench or working on non-billable projects. And the other number are the number of hours that you worked on billable projects. So here, so for this first person, they spent 160 hours this month working on billable projects, 0 hours on the bench, and so on and so forth. So this is something, a type of thing that you'll see commonly in different professional services firms. Again, accounting. In my career, I've worked in accounting and in engineering firms, but I've also seen it in law firms and in various other places. And so this originally was broken out in more detail. Say, so for this particular employee, for instance, we had a month's worth of data for them. So we see on the first of the month, they worked maybe 8 hours on something and 0 hours on something else and so on and so forth. There was a larger spreadsheet that had a full month's worth of data for all of these, what do we have here, 494 employees. And so it was about 6,000 rows worth of data. I used one Python script to just sort of sum these all up so that I would get the totals, the monthly totals for each person. That in and of itself, not terribly exciting in Python because that's easy enough to do in Excel. The next step, however, is you've got this data, and you can see here you've got the employee. So each row is a unique employee, and they're working in a particular sub-department in a particular company. So what the managers, and you see here you've got the manager name, what the manager of that sub-department or of the larger department that sub-department belongs to, what they want to see is, okay, well, in a company that measures things based on billing or utilized time versus non-utilized time, they want to know, well, how did my people perform this month? How well utilized were they? But sub-department 52PO2, for instance, might not be in the same department as 52PO6 or 52AO4. So the trick here is, how do I generate a report? How do I split these out so that I have these people grouped the way they're supposed to be? And then that's where Python becomes a little more useful. So I've written a separate script that takes that data and splits it out. So here, you've got that data, and it's separated so that each of the subdepartments is grouped together. And in a later version of this, there you'll have totals for each subdepartment. But then if you look along, I don't know if it's visible here, along the bottom, you've got different tabs. And on each tab is a department that contains multiple different subdepartments. And so here, that's a bad example. Look at the accounting department. So here you can see these are the different subdepartments that are in the accounting department, and you can see the utilization, the bench hours, the billable hours, the total hours for this person, and then their bench utilization and their billable utilization. So lots of these people just weren't billable at all. And there are, I believe, what, 13 or 14 different tabs here with the different subdepartments making up these larger departments. So how or why is this useful? The problem with doing this in Excel is, and this is perfectly doable in Excel with the pivot table, for instance. The problem is to get these different reports broken out, these different subdepartment groupings broken out. You have to have a pivot table and then filter it individually by each subdepartment and then copy and paste, filter, copy, paste, filter, copy, paste, filter, copy, paste, filter, copy, paste. And it's a time-consuming and a manual process, and there's a lot of manual adjustment that goes on. But then also, in any corporate structure, you'll have reorganizations, you'll have changes, so that maybe sub-department, let's say this one, 57100, that was in this engineering department now, maybe it moves to another larger department next month or the month after. So what I've done here is I've taken a JSON file, which is like a Python dictionary. I've got a mapping of, so for the engineering department, I've got a mapping, engineering department being the key, and then I've mapped the different subdepartments to engineering, and then it will go through that larger list and separate them for me and create the different spreadsheet tabs. And if there's a change in the organizational structure, I only have to change this one JSON file and run this second piece of Python code again. And the process of creating all this, again, takes about 120 seconds. As opposed to hours and hours of copying and pasting. So I'm showing that just sort of as an example of why would I need to, you know, why would a person want or need to use Python to process things in a spreadsheet? So this is something that you can do just by accessing the spreadsheet file itself. You don't actually have to have Python code running inside your spreadsheet application. So next, the next example is running Python code in a spreadsheet application. And I've sort of got this talk timed such that there should be time for question and answers at the end. If anybody has a burning question in the middle, please feel free to raise your hand. But if not, there should be some time for questions and answers at the end, if anybody has any. So the second example of running Python code in a spreadsheet application. So here, the use case is going to be that you've decided there's functionality that you want to add to Excel or to another spreadsheet program. From your Python, from the Python code that you've written already. So you've got some sort of a workflow based in a spreadsheet, but there's a certain type of processing, there's a certain calculation or a certain type of data manipulation and that needs to be done. And it would be easier or better to do in Python, but instead of writing a custom function in Visual Basic, you can write the function in Python, or perhaps you've already written the function in Python, and now you can expose it to your spreadsheet application. And it's important to point out that a lot of this, the data that comes to people in the form of spreadsheets isn't always numeric. Sometimes it's text, but it's not always clean text. You've got trailing spaces and extra weird characters and blah, blah, blah. And spreadsheets in general aren't always optimized for handling text or processing that text or cleaning it up well. It's often a lot easier to do that sort of thing with Python. And so if you can write a function that does that sort of cleanup for you and then expose it to your spreadsheet program, that can make your life simpler. So I see this as one of the bigger growth areas for Python, is essentially replacing Visual Basic with Python. So instead of going through the process of learning Visual Basic, which is a language that only works in one particular environment, you can learn how to do these things in Python, and those skills can be carried across from Windows, and beyond just Windows, the Microsoft Office environment, but any other Windows program, or to the Mac OS, or to Linux, or what have you. And I also see this as an opportunity. So for current Pythonistas who suddenly find themselves confronted with spreadsheets, well, you can, you know, depending on the processing you've got to do, you can write your own custom functions to do what you need, pull them into Excel. But I also think it is an interesting point to bring new non-programmers into Python, because like, well, hey, now you can write your own functions, and you know, you can look at the Python code, and it's not that hard to write some basic functions that will do some basic things, especially when it comes to text manipulation. Most spreadsheet programs just aren't well set up for that sort of thing, whereas you know the string methods that exist in Python just right out of the box are fantastic for a lot of things. So we looked at a couple of different packages here that will let you do this, that will let you actually run Python code in a spreadsheet. One is called Python for Excel, Pixel from nthought, the people who bring you the Canopy distribution. It's P-Y-X-L-L, it's pronounced Pixel. And I think as Glenn, our organizer, is also a member of our Python meetup in Houston, and when I presented this to them, he asked this question, the XLL in the name, is that because it's a DLL? Well, yes, that's how this is implemented. nthought has a DLL, a dynamically linked library, that once it's loaded, gives Excel access to your Python code. And so with the Pixel website and with some of their videos, they talk about some of the different virtues that you get from using something like Pixel. And so they talk about them specifically, but these things apply to any of the solutions that I'll mention here. If you have people who are using, and have many of you had to deal with a spreadsheet with some sort of like complicated Excel macro built, some sort of VB macro built into it that does some sort of magical processing in the background, and you're like, oh, okay, well, it's doing the thing. Those are fine in as much as they work. The problem is that, and you can sort of jump through some hoops to try to protect that code, but what often happens is, you know, I send a spreadsheet to somebody, and they change it, and somebody else changes it later, either with VBA macros or functions, or with just a complicated formula that ends up being written in a cell somewhere. And so anytime you're using code that's not tied specifically to the spreadsheet, you can have this sort of centralized management of code so that all your spreadsheets are using the same function across the board instead of everyone sort of slightly modifying this set of functions or formulas based on their preferences. So again, the centralized management of functions. So you get a spreadsheet that gets moved from one office to another, and it gets changed as it goes around based on someone's preferences, or you know, oh well, I prefer that it looked like this, or I prefer that it looked like that. But if the spreadsheet is being used in different parts of the company to provide some sort of a calculation or a result, you run the risk of not getting the same result in every location. So now maybe Hong Kong gets one result, and Chicago gets a different result, and Houston has a slightly different result, depending on edge cases, because you've got these formulas being changed around. And the reality is that while these changes are being made by people who feel that they're comfortable with Excel, none of them are actually programmers in most cases. And one of the things that I've learned from my own experience as far as dealing with not being a professional programmer myself, but you know, being the only programmer in a group of accountants, is that most of them don't really understand the importance of well-structured data or of having your data be clean or in a standardized format. And so, you know, people will write someone's name as, you know, Bob Johnson in one place, and then the next person will write Johnson comma Bob in the next place, and then the next person will write Johnson comma Robert because his actual legal name is Robert, and then someone else will write Johnson comma Robert J because that's his actual full name, his middle name is James. And so, you know, or someone else will write Clint Johnson because while his name is Robert J Johnson, everybody calls him Clint, and so we call him Clint, and that's what shows up in the spreadsheet. So you know, you get all these variations, So you have essentially programmers, non-programmers, doing programming and not really paying attention to the rigor, and the results that you get can be widely varying. And so that's an issue. One thing that I noticed when I was doing the research on this pixel library, which I thought was interesting, was that there's an asynchronous function that you can use that lets you keep Excel from freezing. So if you're doing processing on a large chunk of data, like if you're running Python code, it doesn't always happen instantaneously. And so what you don't want is to have your Python function doing a lot of processing and then your spreadsheet's frozen. And so this asynchronous function allows you to pass the data off, start the processing, and then it returns control to the spreadsheet function so that it's happening asynchronously, so you're not just sort of stuck waiting for Python. I thought that was interesting enough to just sort of mention on its own. I haven't uploaded these yet, but I'll put these on my GitHub, so you'll have access to these notes and the various links that are contained in them. But the unthought pixel page has more information on how to acquire this. This is a package that you have to pay for. This is, I believe, $99 a year for the plugin. This might be a better solution for an enterprise situation, because for something like, for something like this to work, everyone's going to need this $99 plugin. And so in an enterprise situation, that's not really that big of a deal. But if you're working with a smaller team, perhaps it may be a deal breaker. So the next two packages here are XL Wings and XL Python. And I'm talking about these together, one, partially because they do almost the same thing. Two, I saw them presented together. And three, they are planning to merge. So I'm mentioning them here together because, again, they do the same thing. XL Wings, their sort of tagline is, you can replace your VBA code with Python. And XL Python is, you can call Python scripts from XL VBA. So they're doing very similar things. But the presentation I saw was by the main developer for XL Python. And he said that he's already spoken to the XL Wings developer, and they are planning to merge these two projects into one. So I don't know what the new combined name will be, but that's a plan that's already in the works. And again, this is something that will let you run Python code from Excel. This project, PyNX, the goal of this project is to embed a Python interpreter in Excel. I am explicitly not going to talk about this package because tomorrow there is a presentation, there's a 50-minute presentation on this package in and of itself. And so I'm planning to go to that, and I thought instead of me talking about it for 2 minutes or spending time researching it. If I recall correctly, the person who's presenting on this tomorrow is actually the main developer for this project. And it was a project that had been started and abandoned, and this person has revived it and is getting it going again. So I'm thinking that person will have much more insight into it than I will. And so instead of me doing a poor job of discussing it, I will point you to that presentation tomorrow. Maybe at 2? I can't remember exactly. 1 p.m., okay. Is that person here? Is that you? Okay, there we go. So he's here. So tomorrow, 1 p.m., learn about PyNX from the person who actually... was I correct in my... Okay, so there we go. So you can hear the words directly from the actual developer himself instead of my poor version. So, and I'm not going to talk about it. Now, I'd also point out that PyNX is an open source project, yes? Yes, so that has certain benefits. The difference between an open source library or a module versus one that you're having to pay for has strengths and weaknesses depending on what your situation is. If you're in a larger corporate environment, the powers that be may be happier with something that you're having to pay for because they can get a support contract and blah, blah, blah. And so that's one thing. But in another situation, an open source project that you can simply download and make use of might be more useful to a smaller organization. Or in my case, as a rogue Pythonista, I have all manner of things installed on my computer that no one really knows about. And the fact that I haven't had to pay for those has been helpful because that money came out of my pocket. So I would turn my work machine into a development machine nobody really knows. But that's just sort of what that is. So again, open source versus a paid project, strengths and weaknesses depending on your unique situation. Don't be like me and run the risk of being fired. I'm not advocating that. I'm just saying, just pointing out what happened. So this third option is something I'm still looking into. actually scripting spreadsheet applications. And the use case here is a situation where you might want to include a spreadsheet app as part of some sort of a Python-based workflow, where maybe you've got some data that needs to be processed, but there are also some things that you'd want to do to it within a spreadsheet application. Because there are certain things that are simple and fast to do within a spreadsheet application, and then other things that aren't. or maybe you've got some sort of requirement where the results of what you do have to be in a spreadsheet because you got to pass those results off to someone else, and they want to see a spreadsheet because they like spreadsheets. And so this is a situation where, as I said, you'd be basically using a spreadsheet application as sort of in a way that you would use a web service or any other API that you would have access to. And unfortunately, in the time that I had, the documentation was not as wonderful as I would have hoped. So with the Open and LibreOffice office suites, those come to mind. There is a PyUno bridge. UNO being, and I've got here a list of links. UNO tools are a set of tools that are designed to make it easy for OpenOffice and LibreOffice to be scripted. However, most of the documentation centers around Java. There is some documentation for using Python, but it's relatively limited, and I didn't have an opportunity to dig into this as deeply as I would have liked. But there are a number of different resources. There's also a little bit of confusion because, as you may know, LibreOffice is a fork of OpenOffice, so they share a common code base. There are a lot of commonalities there, so sometimes if you're looking for information on how to do some sort of development with LibreOffice, you'll just be pointed to a link to the OpenOffice materials. But those haven't always been updated as quickly as the LibreOffice software itself has been. And so that's a bit of a trick. But for situations where you might want to do some processing and then call to a spreadsheet application and have it do something for you and then give you back those results and then go on with something else, this is sort of that third option that I'm thinking of. Or if you just sort of want your results to then be put into a spreadsheet file. But for that, you could also use the first option of just writing your results to a spreadsheet file. So some issues and caveats that I felt were important to point out. Using any of these methods, whether it be just dealing with the spreadsheet file itself or running your code within a spreadsheet application, they leave you vulnerable to changes in the application itself or the file format. And the big danger here is really more with Excel. If there are changes to, say, OpenOffice or LibreOffice, one of those applications, those formats are open, and so changes to those would be available, and it would be easier to find those changes and learn how to deal with them. Whereas changes to the Excel application or to their format, Microsoft has sort of notoriously, and maybe not with poor reason based on their business model, they've been sort of secretive about that sort of thing and haven't always done the best job as far as making those changes clear and obvious to people. And so if you start to build a larger workflow around this sort of a thing, you need to be aware that, okay, here's the vulnerability here. For instance, the change from the XLS format to the XLSX format, and before that, I believe like in Office 95, the change from Office 95 to Office 97, those file formats weren't compatible. So there's a question in the back.
The trick is that these different formats, like Word.doc on its own, has different variations for each generation of Microsoft documents.
Yes.
And .docx is not the same in Office 2010 and 2013.
Yes.
Or possibly on Mac 2011. And it's actually a terrible idea to utilize these formats to keep your corporate data or personal data. So it supports, incidentally, ODS and all these other Yeah. It's about this, like, merge to, you know, and then you end up, you know, not actually being able to use your whole data after several years.
Exactly. And so for the benefit of the video recording, I'll repeat the essence of the question, which is that even just within the Microsoft Office products, there is often variation between formats, and you'll find incompatibilities within the formats. And using an open standard for your documents is a better choice. And I agree with all that 100%. However, the reality in many situations is, if you're in a work environment, you might get an XLS, you know, file. I'm specifically talking about XLS, but it's the same for spreadsheet files or Word files or PowerPoint files. This is what you're given to work with, and you need to do something with it. And so it is unfortunate, but it's true. And I've seen it myself as people move from one version of Excel or Word to the other, then you get internal incompatibilities or situations where, well, we started. So for instance, you know, we started the rollout of Office 2013. And so now the people on the left side of the room have Office 2013. People on the right side of the room, you still have Office 2007. And so maybe your files will work with these people's files. Maybe they won't. Maybe they'll kind of work and there'll be a little weird difference. So that's an issue. But again, that's related to the point that I'm pointing out here, is that one has to be cognizant of these changes, of the risks that exist in these changes in file format. And again, using a more open file format minimizes those risks, but you might not have a choice depending on your work environment. Maybe you're a Microsoft shop and these are the formats you have to deal with, but it's good to be aware of those risks. Again, the rise of the open document format minimizes this. Other things that I'm still sort of looking into, using Google Docs, so I had here that had the question of working with Google Docs spreadsheets with Python, because a friend from our local Python meetup came to me asking about that, and I found that I came across this GSpread, which is a library that you can find in PyPy that will allow you to work with Google Docs spreadsheets by way of Python. So that's something interesting. One of our, actually Glenn, who was the organizer, the chair for this conference, but also a member, the organizer of the Python web meetup in Houston and goes to our meetups, he gave a presentation on Piwi, which is an ORM, and it had some functionality. It had an add-on that was designed to work with CSV files. Now, I know at the beginning of this, I talked about not wanting to use CSV files because there's a sort of extra step, but it seemed like something that might be sort of worthwhile to investigate, because again, if we go back to the issue of file format incompatibilities from one version of an Office program to another, one way to get around those incompatibilities is to just save something to a CSV. So there's some docs there. Some other CSV file options. And again, there are many different, there's a CSV module included in standard Python. So there are other options for that. It's not my preferred approach, but it's an option that might be necessary depending on what your situation is. So that's all I've got, really. Again, the main focus on those sort of three general approaches. If there are any questions that anyone has or comments, I'd be happy to entertain them. I did at one point, but I can't recall why it didn't come up, why I didn't look at it here. But I think it might have been like the fact that it was a paid option, and I think if I were going to look at paid options, I would be more inclined to look at the Pixel option, just because I know that InThought has, well, I guess for lack of a better term, because I'm more familiar with InThought and with the work that they've done in the scientific Python community and that sort of thing. So I might be a little more inclined to go with their offering than Data Nitro. But I haven't actually, that's almost entirely emotional. I haven't done an actual comparison of functionality. And it's been probably 2 years, if not more, since I've looked at Data Nitro. So who knows how it's progressed. But an excellent point. Data Nitro is another option. Any other questions, comments? And I'd also point out that this wasn't intended to be an exhaustive list of all of the options that were available, because nobody wants to just here's a list of libraries, read them now. That's not terribly exciting. I tried to focus on things that I had actually worked with just to a certain extent, or had enough research time to form some sort of a useful opinion on, and to try to share that, because I thought that would be a little more useful. So, question? Yes. One of the exceptions being the Open LibreOffice stuff. There weren't many examples there. But if we go back to the earlier things about OpenPyXL versus the Python XL utilities, XLRD, both of those have examples. But the OpenPyXL documentation and examples are more up to date. The documentation is more up to date. I can recall when I was in working with it, sort of watching their documentation change and watching their examples get updated. Whereas the documentation for the XLRD, XLWT libraries is a little older. But the OpenPyXL stuff, I mean, there's just a lot of simple copy paste, boom, and you know it'll work for you. With the others, there are examples there as well. Again, the Python for Excel, the Pixel, I haven't had an opportunity to play with it yet directly because I haven't bought their plugin. But the Excel Wings and Excel Python also have examples. So, any other questions, comments? So, and I'm sorry, I didn't repeat the earlier question. The earlier question was about examples, quality of examples, and you know, do all these different places have quality examples that you can use? And the answer to that is yes. This question being, which would be the easiest for maybe for non-programmers or for novice programmers to get started with? Well, so if you're actually wanting that code to run within Excel, and you're trying to pass that along to other people, that's going to, I'm not sure that there's going to be a sort of a simpler answer there, because to actually get the code to run in Excel, you'll need to actually add something to those people's Excel. You know, now what might be easier for a novice to use is for you to write that code in Python, and then have it work on an Excel file, and then you could just, you know, pass that. Well, and they'd have to have a Python interpreter on their machine, but you could just then say, here's the file, here's the Python file, and whatever necessary libraries. Here's the Excel file. Just run this. If you're trying to pass this along to novices to actually make use of, I think the working with an XLS file directly would be the simpler option. So, I think we are running out of time. No, we've got maybe 5 more minutes. But if anyone has more questions, even after this, I'm here tomorrow as well. I'm giving a presentation tomorrow morning at 10, a D&D-based guide to contributing to the Python community and inclusivity. So that should be exciting. I have no dice. I won't be rolling dice. I might acquire some dice this evening, who knows? Like, you know, you never know. But so I'll be around, you know, definitely until at least 11 o'clock tomorrow morning, because I'm presenting until then. But I should be around just in general. I am the tall, handsome man with the shiny head, so I should be easy to spot. So, so if you have any questions after this, feel free to just stop me and say, "Hey, spreadsheet guy," and I'll talk to you. So, any questions? Thank you.